I want to talk for a few minutes tonight about a massive lie in the Christian movement. I'm not talking about non-believers tonight. I'm talking about a massive lie in the church. And I want us to come around the cross tonight. Tonight is in three pieces. Now, your community group fits into tonight, and then our late night worship, they all fit together. And the theme of all of them is that you and I would come to understand that we have to stop trying and understand what it means to have a lot more dying in our lives so that we can really experience all of what God is putting in our hearts in these days. It would be futile and an incredible disservice to you if our message to you was, this is what God wants you to do. He wants you to go out and live these great God-glorifying lives of sacrifice. Go do that. And somehow in the interpretation of it all, the application of it all, you left here thinking, I now have to go and figure out how to do this stuff. I have to go figure out how to love God with all my heart. I haven't been able to figure that out up to this point. How many of you have a track record of success and consistency in loving God with all of your heart up to the days of your spiritual journey from when you met Christ to tonight? Your story is, I've just always gone after Him. I've always been consistent in pursuing Him. I've always had this reckless abandon to know Him more. I've always been there in pursuit of Him. I've always put Him front. I've always put Him center. I've always sought to enjoy Him in my life. I've succeeded in doing that in my spiritual journey. How many of you tonight, is that your story? Nobody. So what's different? What in the world is different tonight that we're going to leave here tomorrow afternoon and we're going to go love God with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength? What's different? Why is it going to be different this time than the last time? Why is it going to have a different outcome now than then when you were just as determined, just as motivated? You knew what you wanted to do, but somehow it didn't happen. And maybe not only did the right thing not happen, the wrong thing happened again. And then you found yourself at another conference and another deal, and somebody brought a big cross down to the front, and everybody came and nailed their sins up on the cross again and decided for this moment in my life, I renounce this once and for all. This is going to be it. But it wasn't it. That's why we invented a whole mentality called rededication, which means I'm coming again one more time to tell you, God, that it's going to be different this time. I promise you, God. Have you ever spoken these words? God, this is the last time we're going to have this conversation. You ever told Him that? Anybody in this building ever told Him that besides me? I'm not going to sleep with her again. It's over. We're not crossing those lines anymore. We're not having that kind of physical relationship. God, I'm telling you, if she's not pregnant, we're going to give you praise, and this is going to be it, and we're moving backwards from here. This is a finish line for us, God. We promise you it's going to stop here. How many of you ever told God a prayer like that? Not too many more people want to raise their hands anymore. But it didn't stop there. How many of you felt like you were going under the tide of sexual immorality? I mean, let's be honest tonight. Our mission is to glorify God. But you live in a campus environment where sexual immorality is so much championed and celebrated that a whole industry has emerged on the backs of college men and women. Television commercials on my television and yours tell me that girls have gone wild. They're not mothers and grandmothers and children. They're college students. And they're at Padre Island or Cancun or Daytona Beach, and they're inebriated or possibly just crazy in their own abandon to sensuality, and for whatever you get, a t-shirt or 10 bucks or the joy of knowing that you're on television, they'll bear it all or do it all and put themselves in amazingly compromised positions, and people will pay so much money for it. It's a hundreds of millions of dollar industry. Some of you know what it means to go to sleep and listen to another couple across a hall or suite mates through a bathroom door. And a whole lot of us in this arena know what it is to struggle with the tide, with the lie, with the deception that begins in the mind that there is something better than Jesus. And it's found inside this computer screen, and inside this screen, nobody knows. I'm not going to the bars and picking up people. I'm not hooking up. That's not my deal, because I'm a Christian, and I'm even a leader. But I know the class schedule of my roommate, and I know when I've got an hour of time. And I wonder just if we peeled back all the Isaiah 2:6-8 and all the worship songs for a minute and all the "In This Great" for a minute. And we just thought about this statement. How is it that you can glorify God in a massive way in your world? Is it not by knowing, believing, comprehending, and embracing the fullness of the reality that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, and that you are not your own? You were bought with a price. Therefore, the outcome in a sexual context, according to Paul, is that you would glorify God in your body. And in so doing, would broadcast in stereo magnification to your world, Jesus is better than pornography. Jesus is better than my little self-fantasy world of masturbation. Jesus is better than me diving down into the depths of sexual perversion. I have tasted and seen that the Lord is good. And you know what? He's better. That's all I can tell you. It's telling me, come here. But I'm telling you that He's better in my life. I'm not talking about getting on a soapbox and saying, hey, all you immoral people out there, you shouldn't be living like that. I'm just saying, I'm a 20-year-old, I'm a 21-year-old, I'm a 30-year-old college pastor, a 40-year-old, a 50-year-old, and guess what? I'm in the battle. Yes, I get it. Yes, I'm struggling. Yes, it's a temptation, but Jesus is better. There may be, I don't know women, okay, so we're in mixed company, and I don't know women. I don't know if you struggle with sexual temptation. I don't know if you struggle. But I know that I would be shocked if there are 50 men in this building who would go, what? Huh? I say God bless you if that's you. It's not me. And I think there are a lot of us men who are supposed to be leading this thing. Do you understand what I mean when I say that, women? And I just wonder if we just peeled back all this for a minute. And we just talked. Who in the arena tonight would say, I'm in deep, and I think I'm going under? Because I've been swallowing this lie for so long that it's become a part of me. I'm two people. I'm this guy, and I'm a completely different guy. And somewhere in your heart, you're wondering, is it different this time? Was there enough inertia in the arena to somehow kick you out of a cycle that's been haunting you for years? And I've got the answer for you. The answer is no. There was not enough emotion, not enough energy, not enough sense of symphony, not enough bravo in this moment to break chains off of us that have been on us for a long, long time, in some cases for a lifetime. And maybe in the back part of your mind, you said, you know what? I love being here, and I love this, but I've already predetermined in my heart that probably when I get back to my world, back to my little place, back to my little pattern where the temptations come the way they do and the opportunities are there, I'm probably going back again. So I'm just going to grab what I can while we're here. And I think there are some of us in the building, and there's a place in you that you really just don't believe it's possible for you to really experience the fullness of God. We're calling all of us to a 268 lifestyle. There are five statements in your little program that you got. How do you do that? How do you love God? How do you build unity on your campus? How do you care about the lost? How do you invest in the local church? How do you put your life in tune with God's global purpose? How do you do that? How do you go back and be selfless? How do you go back and be Godward? How do you go back and be less of you and more of God? How do you go back and be pure? How do you go back and break the chains? How do you do that? And I just want you to know, as Passion, we are not asking you to go and live out the 268 declaration. We're not asking you to go out and live out this life. We're not asking you to do it. On the contrary, rather, God is inviting you to come and die. To come and die to what? To come and die to self-trying and self-power, so that Christ can live out the 268 declaration in a Godward life in and through you to the glory of God. There are a few lies I want to talk about tonight, and the first one is this. The first lie is you can do it. That's the first lie. Some of you are on that lie right now. You're ready to go. I'm going to do it. I'm going. I'm doing this. I'm doing that. I can do it. No, you can't. It's a lie. The truth is that you and I can't live the Christian life. We talked about just loving God. How many of you have incredible success and consistency in your time alone with God? Show of hands. Fantastic. How many of you have incredible consistency in your devotion life of prayer? Okay, cool. Some of you are getting there. I mean, everybody doesn't have to be a complete miserable failure. I mean, we got a few people maturing into Christ's power. How many of you are just finding incredible consistency and success in your life in loving the hard-to-love people in your world? How many of you are finding a lot of success and consistency in not being full of yourself and being full of God all the time? How many of you are finding a lot of success in sharing the gospel to people who are dying and going to an eternity without God? How many of you are finding consistent success in fighting off temptation of any kind? Nobody. Look around. We're a bunch of miserable failures at the Christian life. We can't even do the basic things, much less go and die for the cause of Christ around the world. I got news for you. If you've ever thought the Christian life is difficult, and you thought, you know, this is not as easy as I thought it was going to be. I came to some thing, and everybody was singing some song, and I felt great, and I met Jesus, and I got a Bible, and I was born again, and I thought, wow, and then I found out this thing's really hard. Well, I got news for you. The Christian life isn't hard. The Christian life isn't even difficult. The Christian life is impossible. There's only one guy who's ever been able to pull it off. And he was so good at it, they named it after him. There's only been one person who successfully pulled off the Christian life. And it isn't me, and it certainly isn't you. But Jesus, thank God, lived the Christian life. He lived it on earth, and he's living it now. And the joy is that God isn't saying to you and to me, hey, you can do it. God's saying, you can't do it. If you think you can do it, you're just about to stumble and fall. If you think you can stand it, look out. You're a candidate for falling. You can't do it. I'm not asking you to do it. I know you can't do it. I know how hard it is. I know it's impossible. I know you. This isn't going to work for you. But it has worked once. And the good thing about the fact that Christ did live the Christian life is that he's still with us. Meaning he's still living the Christian life. And God is saying to you tonight, and he's saying to me, I'm not asking you to go and live the Christian life. I'm telling you, you can't live the Christian life. But I'm telling you, I know who can, and I have an idea. I'm going to put the one who can live the Christian life inside of the one who can't live the Christian life so that the one who can live the Christian life can live the Christian life through the one who can't live the Christian life. That is the mystery of the gospel. Paul wrote it this way in Colossians, and I love the passage. Now I rejoice, Colossians 1, verse 24, in what was suffered for you, and I fill up in my flesh what is still lacking in regard to Christ's afflictions for the sake of his body, which is the church. I have become its servant by the commission God gave me to present to you the word of God in its fullness. Key word. Hello? Time out. What is Paul saying? He's saying, up to now, there's been an amazing unfolding of a story. Christ came as a fulfillment of prophecy of all Old Testament. Christ died, was buried, and was raised from the dead. But guess what? There's a fullness of this story that still isn't understood, and I think that's true even today. He said, I'm here to proclaim the word and the gospel in all of its fullness. Verse 26, the mystery that has been kept hidden for ages and generations, but is now disclosed to the saints. In other words, Daniel didn't know this. David didn't know this. Moses didn't know this. Abraham didn't know this. Micah didn't know this. Rahab didn't know this. But you're going to get to know it, is what Paul said. It's being now made known to the saints. You're saying saints who? The people that are carved in stone around the top of the church? No, the saints. If you look at the first words of the book of Colossians, it tells us who the saints are. It's the people he's writing to. He says, Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to the holy and faithful brothers in Christ at Colossae. Now, when you read that out of NIV, and you've heard me say this plenty of times, the NIV lets you down a lot of times, and in this translation, it does. This holy and faithful one is translated, really, to the saints. In other words, anybody in Christ has been made new and holy in Christ, and that's the same concept word for saint in the New Testament. Saint isn't somebody who lived a fantastic life and we're remembering how good they were. Saint is someone who's been made holy by the power of God. And so he's saying this mystery is now being made known to the people whom God has made holy in Jesus Christ. That's how you get made holy. So he said, now this mystery is revealed or disclosed to the saints. Verse 27, to them God has chosen to make known among the Gentiles the glorious riches of this mystery. And here it comes. Are you ready? Paul's saying, hey, nobody's known this yet, but it's my commissioning from God to broadcast this to the church. And here it comes, he said, and this is the mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. You want to live a life that glorifies God? You want to live a life for His fame, for His name, for His renown? You want to live a life that makes much of God? Then you have to know the mystery, because the mystery is the operational element and the power that produces the glory of God in us. And it is Christ in you. God was so convinced of our utter inability to live out the Christian life that He gave us the mystery of mysteries, the incarnation of Christ in human flesh. And He's saying to you tonight, I'm not talking about believing in something so you can go somewhere when you die. I'm talking about receiving something that becomes in you a power source for when you live. We have this question all the time. Do you know for sure if you die tonight that you go to heaven? Well, it's a good question. I'm not knocking the question at all. It's a great question. I don't know why it's always tonight. I don't know why when I ask people, do you know what would happen if you died today? We're always asking them, if you died tonight, do you know for sure that you go to heaven? It's a great question. You should have an answer to that question in your own heart. But how about this question? If you don't die tonight and you wake up tomorrow, do you have the hope and confidence of a power source that will enable you to live triumphantly tomorrow? Because most of us, Lord willing, are not going to die tonight. We're going to wake up tomorrow with the question in our hearts, has something happened to me powerful enough to free me into a life that is changed and different? And God is saying the first lie is that you can do it. And if you think you can beat sexual temptation, you're going under. If you think you can figure out how at this conference to change your path, you're going under. If you think you can rededicate enough, have you ever rededicated your rededication? Man, that's the biggest drag of all time. Have you ever done that where it's like, Lord, I know I told you last time that was the last time, but I'm telling you, this time, it is the last time. And then have you ever rededicated the rededication of your rededication? Have you ever been there? Lord, I know that other time I told you that the time before that when I told you, but now I'm telling you this time. And God's like, you need to wake up. We don't need any more rededication now. Now, if you think rededication is about recommitment, it's about refocus of my life, it's about all in a fresh way today, putting my life in the hands of God, then go for rededication. I'm for it. But if rededication to you means, I promise you, God, I'm telling you, God, I've decided, God, I'm going to change it all, God, I'm not doing that anymore, God, I'm telling you, this is the moment, God. And God's looking back at you going, oh, really? I doubt it. I bet you'll be back to rededicate your rededication. If there's I in your rededication, it ain't gonna work, because you can't. I can, but you can't. That's why the mystery, and that's why I'm giving you not the belief in someone named Jesus. That's why I'm giving you Jesus, to come and live in you. I am crucified with Christ, Paul said. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ lives in me. Hello? Amen. And we're going, God, I promise you, I'm going to do this and I'm going to do that. And Jesus is going, well, hello? Over here? The mystery is Christ in you, the hope of glory. That little word, I-N-N, is such a major word. If you're into words like I'm into words, I mean, you got to be into N. I mean, like it's N. Praise God for N. We've had a belief system that's Christ and you, the hope of glory. Man, I got Jesus, it's me and him, and we're going to storm the gates of hell, me and Jesus. Here we go. We're a team. We're a dynamic tandem. We're going to knock them out. And Jesus is looking at you like, oh, I think I can work with you. But it's not me and you. I mean, that's not the hope of glory. Christ and you is not the hope of glory. Christ and me is not the hope of glory. Christ and anybody isn't the hope of glory. Christ is the hope of glory. Christ in you, not Christ and you. Not your effort plus his effort equals victory. It's he is victory in you. God knows that you can't, but he knows that he can. Some of you have believed the lie that you can't stop. Most of this all has to do with the fact that we don't know who we are. Some of you have believed the lie that you're just a sinner saved by grace. Uh-oh. Where are you going now? You're about to become a heretic right before all of our eyes. Of course we're just sinners saved by grace. Just a beggar trying to help another beggar find bread. I'm just a sinner. Emphasis on the just word. Like, that's what I am. I'm just a sinner saved by grace. Our identity point being sinner. So that when we sin, we got a fallback strategy. What's the fallback strategy? Well, what did you expect? I'm a sinner. I mean, why don't we just wake up in the morning and haul off and just do a big one right off the bat and get it out of the way? That's what we are. I'm just a sinner. Just a sinner. Oh, saved by grace, that's kind of the little afterthought thing. I mean, it should at least be, I'm just a sinner, saved by grace. But it's, I'm just a sinner, saved by grace. If your mentality is that you're a sinner, then you're going to find it completely ordinary for you to sin. But it's a lie. Just stay with me. If you feel like you're going to bail out on me, just stay with me for a minute. You're not just a sinner saved by grace. You are a sinner, worse, a rebel, worse, an enemy of God, an alienated person from God, hostile towards God, a reviler of God, whom God found in your sinfulness and restored, redeemed, forgave, cleansed, and made holy in Jesus Christ. And he said to you, you are now a holy one of God. You're one of these Colossians people, these Ephesians people, these Corinthians people, these Philippians people. You're a saint. What's really weird is all these books start with, and to the saints, and then they go and talk about their terrible, sinful lives. Stop sinning. Stop being idolaters. Stop being sinful. Stop being sexually immoral. Stop all the sin in your lives. But they open with, dear saints, dear holy ones. Why don't they open up with, you big, fat bunch of wretched sinners? Saved by grace. Because God wants us to know that before we can defeat any lie, we have to know the truth. Truth sets us free. Truth reprograms our mind. Truth transforms us. And before you can defeat any lie from the enemy, you have to know the truth. And if you think you're a sinner, then when sin comes down the road, you're going to go, I can't stop. I can't help it. I can't choose differently. That's what I am. That's what I'm going to do. We have all this genetic business going on. I'm predisposed genetically to be this or that. I mean, I've read an article on everything you can be. I'm predisposed genetically to be lazy. I'm predisposed genetically to be overweight. I'm predisposed genetically to be a person of rage. I'm predisposed genetically to be an alcoholic. I'm predisposed genetically to be a homosexual. I'm predisposed genetically to be compulsive. I'm predisposed genetically to be all these things. And that's why I'm like this, because I'm defective genetically. I've got a problem inside. And I'm like, congratulations for waking up to that. We all have a genetic DNA deficiency. We are sinners. And every one of us is on a path to sinning unless God rescues us and changes us from sinners to holy ones in Christ. It's the whole gospel. Maybe you just got half of it. Amen. Jesus Christ died on a cross for me to forgive my sins. And the rest is up to me. And you didn't get the other half of the gospel. Jesus Christ died on a cross for me to forgive my sins, and he rose from the tomb for me to call me to life again and be life in me and to be righteousness in me and to be God in and through me. And he is the life in me. I love hanging around Christians. I used to speak at a lot of churches in the tradition I came from, and one of our favorite verses is Romans 3:23. Do you know it? Who knows it? Let's just say it together. Romans 3:23, you know it? I'm not waiting for you to turn to it. For all sin. Yeah? Is that it? You could go into most churches and preach an entire sermon on that and get a big fat amen and a pat on the back when you leave. We're just all people who have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Do you hear that phrase? We've come short of what? The glory of God. We've come short of lives that make much of God. How? We've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. And at that point you get, amen, preach it, brother, right on. And then everybody goes out and sins and feels good about it. Well, that's what we are. We're all a bunch of sinners and we've all sinned. The Bible says that. And we've all fallen short of the glory of God. So God will understand my dilemma. Maybe you got a period faith and you thought it said in all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, period. But it doesn't say that in your Bible. Punctuation is the coolest part of the Bible a lot of times. And if you've ever loved the comma, you love the one that's right there. There aren't, I'm guessing, 20 people in here who can confidently keep talking without looking down at your Bible past the comma. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, comma. And I'll tell you why. Because we have been sold half of the gospel. And we thought that was enough. For all have sinned. That is true. And all either are or were, hopefully were, sinners. All have sinned. I have. You have. And fall short of the glory of God. Comma. And are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. In other words, this message is for all of us sinned and fell short of the glory of God, comma, but God has freely justified us, made us right with him. How could he do that? By forgiving our sin. Paul wrote it this way in Colossians chapter 2. I love this passage. He said it like this. He said, when you were dead in your sins, in other words, it wasn't like when you needed help and a little helping hand, but you were dead in your sins, Colossians 2, verse 13. And in the uncircumcision of Christ, and he forgave, check this out, all our sins. Christ isn't on the installment plan. I died for whatever sins you've committed up to now, but from here on out, you ask, I'll forgive again. You ask, I'll forgive again. You ask, I'll forgive again. No, Christ died one time for all sin, for all the sin of your lifetime and my lifetime. And when I come to him for forgiveness, he doesn't dole it out on a daily basis. He doles it out in its fullness, a tide overflowing me and washes me and cleanses me from all sin, past, present, and future. He covers me and calls me forgiven. And he says that in Christ, I'm a holy one. The scripture says it this way, that we have become the righteousness of God in him. Paul wrote in other places, he who knew no sin, Jesus, became sin on our behalf that we might become the righteousness of God in him. 2 Corinthians 5:21. That we might become the righteousness of God in him. If you are a believer in Christ and have put your faith in the cross and the resurrection of Jesus, you are not just a sinner saved by grace. You are a sinner who has been transformed, forgiven, cleansed, and made a holy one in Christ. You have been given a new identity in Jesus Christ, and you are a saint. Now listen to the difference. A sinner may try to do something right. That's a lot of the mentality. I'm just a sinner saved by grace. I'm trying to do the right thing. But a saint is a whole different dilemma. It's someone who's been completely transformed in identity by Christ. Now, can a saint sin? Absolutely. I'm proof of that. Saints can still choose to sin, but it doesn't make them sinners. It makes them saints who have abandoned their sainthood and chosen something less than what God has designed for them. To be a sinner and do something good doesn't make you a saint. And to be a saint who sins doesn't make you a sinner. It just makes you a holy one who's living an unholy life so that God comes along in his word and says, hey, you saints at Passion 05, you holy ones at Passion 05, stop sinning. He doesn't say, hey, you sinners, start trying to act holy. He says, you holy ones, stop sinning. He's telling you who you are. He's saying, change the way you think. Stop saying, I'm just a sinner, I'm just a sinner, I'm just a sinner, and start saying, by God, I'm the righteousness of God. By God, I'm a new creation. By God, I've been made a holy one. By God, I've been cleansed, forgiven. I'm completely and utterly forgiven for all time's sake. I'm the righteousness of God in Christ. And your friends will look at you and go, no, you're not. You're a big, fat sinner. And you're going, I know, no, no, no. I'm a holy one who's sinning temporarily. Because I haven't activated this thing called the power life of Jesus, this person of Christ. You see, the lie is that, well, you can't stop. And there is a truth in that you can't, but the reality is that he can. The scripture says, as many are led by the Spirit, they don't fulfill the desires of the sinful flesh. It starts tonight with you just knowing who you are. And it comes from two angles. Some of you think, I'm never going to be free from this sexual tide. And God's going, oh, yes, you can. Because trust me, Christ is free tonight from sexual temptation. He is free from immorality and impurity. He is free from pornography. He has a living, breathing freedom tonight. He does. And it's available to people who stop trying and start dying. Who die to, I'm going to change. Who die to, I'm going to keep this between me and God and we'll work it out. Anybody done that yet successfully? Anybody in this building going under in the tide of sexual immorality and you've thought, you know what, I'm just going to work this out and it worked? No. Because dying means admitting that I am going under and I can't help myself. Dying means coming to the light. Dying means telling the truth. Dying means going, you know what? I want Christ to live in me, and I know that Christ is in the light, so I've got to step out of the darkness and into the light so that Christ can live his life in me. And we've got to get to a place. Here's my heart and the heart of our leadership team, of all of those of us who are in this, your community group leaders. Here's our heart, that we would make ourselves at Passion 05 irrelevant. Because we would come in here and sing the songs and fill up the place with the anthem of God and talk about his renown and all of his glory, and we would go home and be in bondage to sexual temptation and sexual immorality in our lives, and in so doing, passion would become completely irrelevant to your life. And you go, yeah, that was great, but this is real. And the story tonight, the hope tonight, is that you would step into a community. Somehow we would become a community where just as easily as you can say, you know what, I'm mad at so-and-so and I just need to tell you about it. Just as easily as you say, you know what, I'm really afraid right now. I'm stressed out about this. Can I just confess that to you? Just as easily as you could say to a friend, you know what, that really bugged me and I just want to be honest about it. Just that easily we could say out loud, I am struggling big time with sexual temptation. I'm going down. Maybe something unusual is happening in our group here. But I've talked to a lot of college guys, leaders, the leaders, who were way, way deep in the hole. And somehow our community just doesn't make a way out. There's some kind of a stigma on this sin. It's different than that one. And we're afraid to say, I know I'm a holy one, but I'm living a completely immoral life. And I want to glorify God in my body. I mean, you can press into that translation, and it means in my sexual body. I want to glorify God. I am the temple of God. And part of dying is to say, and you know what? I can't do it by myself. I need your help. I need your help. Before I can get your help, I have to tell you I need your help. It's not all spiritual. Some of you are in a room by yourself. You need to change that this next semester. Some of you have access to your computer in places that you got to just change that. You got to do something crazy, something insane, something radical, something like saying to your friend, you now have possession of my computer, as crazy as that sounds, and when I want to work on it, I have to come to your room. Something insane is saying to a friend, here's a website. Let's go there together, and then every website I visit on my computer will show up in your email box. And you'll have the password, and you can't. You're the only one who can get it off my computer. It's getting in the light. It's telling the truth. It's saying, I can't do this alone. I'm dying to that lie. And I'm dying to trying any harder. And I'm saying to you, Lord, here's my rededication. It's just surrender to say, Christ, I believe that you live in me. And you know I can't do this. But I believe that you can do it in me. I'm completely surrendered to you. Holy Spirit, what is the first step? And trust me, he will tell you in a heartbeat what step one is. And when he tells you, start moving your foot towards the first step, and you will feel the life power of Jesus as you go. You will not feel it before you go. You cannot step back and go, okay, there's the first step. Okay, Jesus, do it. No, that's where you and me come in. And our obedience and surrender and yieldedness is to say, Jesus, I can't take this step, but I believe you can. And so I'm putting my foot forward, believing that you're going to make it land. Thank you, Jesus. I'm trusting you. Every single step is Christ in me, the hope of glory. The whole gospel is that you are free and clean. Some of you are on the right path. You're just carrying all the guilt and shame from the past with you. The shame of abortion, the shame of sexual immorality, the shame of losing your virginity, the shame of being in compromised places. And you're on the right path, but the whole way you're just having the crud beat out of you by the accuser. And he's telling you, yeah, you're never going to glorify God, not in your life, not with your past, not with the stuff that you've been about. And that condemnation, the guilt, the shame of that, they just perpetually are attached to you like a ball and chain that you're dragging on into your pursuit of God's enjoyment. It's a lie. You've believed a lie. You've believed that it's okay for you to go forward from here, but that you're going to have to continually drag the ball of there. And God's saying, no, you're free. You're free from that. You're washed from that. There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ. None. This Colossians 2 passage goes on to say, and I'll close with this, I love it. He says, and he has forgiven all of our sins. And he's taken the decree that was hostile towards us. That is the summation of all of our sin against God. And he's taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross of Christ. So when the voice of accusation comes, if you don't know the truth, you start going, good night. I almost forgot about her or him like you really could. And you're in your prayer life. You ever been praying or worshiping and all of a sudden the movie started, full color DVD widescreen, and there you are and you're going, oh man, I don't want to look at that. I forgot. I try to put that away. And the enemy's going, oh, Mr. and Mrs. Christian, Mr. and Mrs. Passion Person, Mr. and Mrs. I'm going to glorify God. Well, I'd like to show you your past. And you're like, oh no. And all the weight starts to come down. Unless you know the truth. And when he comes, the voice of accusation, and says, do you know what you've done? Don't you remember what you've done? Don't you remember who you are and what you've done? You say, you want to talk about what we've done? You want to talk about what I've done? Are you here to talk to me about what I've done in my past? Is that why you're here? It is? Okay, great. Let's do that together. You and me, let's talk about my past, you and me. My past, the certificate of debt, and all the decrees that were written against me and were hostile towards me, they have been taken out of the way and they have been nailed to the cross of Jesus Christ. Don't you love looking at that? I want you to look at the cross of Jesus with me and celebrate the cross of Jesus Christ. All the shame, all the guilt, all the failure, all my sin and immorality have been nailed to the cross, Satan. Isn't it a beautiful cross? Oh, where'd you go? And where he went was next door to you, and he knocked on the door next door, and somebody opened the door, and he said, do you have a clue who you are? Yeah, I'm just a sinner saved by grace. Great to meet you. If you think you can do it, it's a lie. You can't. I got great news for you. God's not asking you to. if he thought you could, he wouldn't have moved heaven and earth to send the Son of God to live his life in you. Some of you think you can't stop, and in your own strength you can't, but Christ is free, free, free tonight, and powerful and available. Some of you thought you were going to have to carry that shame all the way to your grave, and you're not, because it's already buried with Christ and washed away forever. You big, fat bunch of saints. Stop sinning and believing the lie that anything is better than Jesus.